Hello. Just to be clear, this episode of the Lincolncast, which will go up a couple of days before the actual episode of the Lincolncast for the week, is a Bioshock Infinite spoiler cast. We will be spoiling the entire game here, and I'm putting this here in front because I forgot to say so at the top of the show. So if you just finished the game and want to hear our perspectives on it, listen. Hello and welcome to the Lincolncast. This is the Giant Bomb Community's Bioshock Infinite podcast. I almost fucked that up entirely. Joining me today is Shinboy 630. What's up, Shinboy?
You stole my intro, you son of a bitch.
Yes, I did, but I didn't.
They don't know that.
Well,
I mean, they do because I just told them.
Yeah, you just told them. It was his idea. Tyler is also here with us. Commodore Jenkins.
Just Leroy Jenkins.
But I couldn't rename his image on Skype, so it's just going to be Tyler for the rest of the show.
That's fine.
That's fine.
You might recognize me from the shit show that was the PAX live stream.
The complete fucking train wreck?
Yes.
That was the PAX live stream?
The Cards Against Humanity stream followed by the PAX.
Here, Cynic, if you want perspective on that stream, you know how much of a shit show it was?
Yeah.
Better than expected.
Oh, wow.
Yeah,
Hold on.
Surprisingly well, actually.
Yeah, it was surprisingly well.
Dude, when it opened up, and what are we talking about? We're supposed to be talking about Bioshock Infinite. All right. So, when did you guys finish the game? I finished the game yesterday, my time. So, it'd be like
I finished the game about 23 and a half hours ago.
You're right.
I finished it like 4 hours ago.
And I thankfully went back and replayed the ending just before the show started, and Shinboy can attest to that because you have to wait for me.
Yep.
Man, that ending. So you guys want to start with the end and then go backwards?
I do at least.
All right.
So
there's just so much to say. This is the hard part. Like this whole day I wanted to talk about this ending, and I've been so used to not talking about it.
Oh my god, that was awesome.
It was. I was sitting there specifically at that part when like you get warped and like you see like the seaweed in front of the window, and I was sitting there. I said audibly, like out loud, I was like,
no way.
See, it was funny because like while I was playing the game, I was kind of half expecting them. It's like, oh, maybe like we'll see Rapture for 5 seconds in one of the tears. But then we actually are in Rapture. I was like, holy shit, I want to just like walk around Rapture, fight a Big Daddy again, just for all time's sake.
I'll take this opportunity to say we are going to spoil the fuck out of this game.
Yeah, so sorry if you're listening before and you haven't got to that part.
I completely forgot to say it this
time. Something like before the music.
It's going to be called the Bioshock Infinite spoiler cast. If they don't read the whole title, then fuck
that's
it.
Their problem.
Yeah, and that's not that big a spoiler. Like
yes,
the how you get to Rapture
might also spoil the original Bioshock. Just as a warning,
how you get to Rapture is like way more interesting than getting to Rapture in the first place. But it is a surprise, like, oh shit, oh my god moment, where it's like, what is happening? Why am I here?
Yeah, because like I was like, you know, looking out the window, and I was like, no, this is not happening. Then I look over, and there's like the Securus or whatever door there.
Yep.
And I just had this big, dumb smile on my face. It's like, Ken Levine, you beautiful man, you.
And it was just
part about that, but after the songbird, like, basically dies,
yep.
You look across to, like, one of the hallways, there's a Big Daddy and a little sister just kind of just sitting there.
Really?
I don't know. I didn't even see that.
What?
Really? I went up
that's
the stairs.
That's what it looked like to me.
Okay.
I definitely saw a Big Daddy suit. That would
make sense.
So, to be clear here, we're referring, because pretty much the internet has been ablaze with one word, thanks for this game. It's the multiverse. That's now a word again in modern fiction, apparently. Because no one can stop talking about it. Because a lot of people like thought that Songbird dying in the water in Rapture, the technology for Big Daddy was taken from Songbird's corpse, which is why I'm surprised that he's already there.
See, if you think about it, this is the way I think about it. If you think about the ending of Bioshock Infinite, there's a big focus on quantum mechanics.
Yep.
Yeah.
And that whole theory of infinite universes.
Mm-hmm.
So that rapture may not have been in the same universe as the Columbia that you left from to get there.
Yeah, oh yeah, absolutely not. That. No, that's absolutely.
Meaning that like it may not be the quote unquote multiverse, because if you're going by their theory, in half the universe's rapture exists and in half it does not.
No, it's their theory. Okay, so do you guys want to jump straight into the multiverse, the multiple worlds interpretation?
That's pretty much what this quantum game mechanics is all about. Or
yeah, do you guys want to talk about like the emotional resonance of the ending? Because I think that one, that part is definitely there. Like, there's definitely interest in discussing.
I kind of want to dig into, like, I guess you can call it the mechanics of the ending.
Okay, sure.
Because I applaud Ken Levine for having the nerve to create an ending to a mass marketed mainstream video game.
Yep.
Where if you don't have at least a base understanding of the principles of quantum mechanics, you will be lost.
Perhaps I'm just an elitist. I was actually surprised about the people who were like just confused by the ending. Mm-hmm. I thought he did an incredibly good job of like easing you into his idea.
Because like Booker is just like, I don't understand. And yeah. Then Elizabeth is like, you don't need to.
Or how do you pronounce it? Lisette? Or like, how do you?
That was like Lucrece.
Lucette?
Something like that.
Let's go with Lucette. That's easy to say.
I think it's Lucette. There's Lucette twins.
No R in it.
Yeah.
The twins, let's just say, the twins like pretty much break it down for you as the game goes along, especially if you're picking up the audio logs. Like, their ones were always the ones I was like, yeah, when I ever saw like the chick's face, I was like, yeah, this is going to be a good audio log as opposed to those ones, the crazy religious ones. Because those ones always provide like significant insight. So like their thing, which is the twins met through the two versions of the same person, which is the set, investigating the same Adam across two universes.
It's
stumbled
weird,
across like, each other.
Because it's like she, I was reading something on the Bioshock Wiki where like she created him as an alternate version of herself, and then they met.
Yeah,
I totally missed
no,
that
I don't
part.
I don't think that's
like, I might
the
have
case.
Just like skipped over that audio log.
They definitely were. I know what you're talking about when talking. They're investigating the same Adam because there's one right after that where it's just like, if you can levitate an Adam, why not an apple? And if you can levitate an apple,
why
not
a
city?
Which I found.
Yeah, I knew
really
that.
Dumb.
I knew that she helped create the city, like the technology used to make the city. I got that part.
So like along the way, I think it was midway through the game, about halfway, you pick up one of her audio logs, and she is discussing meeting her. By the way, I thought they were husband and wife when I first met them.
No, they're brothers.
But I knew they were.
Twins. Yeah, you because they finished each other's sentences. That's kind of supposed to indicate that they're twins, right? But you pick up an audio log, and she's discussing how like her experimentation with the set field and its effect on atoms, and then meeting her identical twin in another universe through Morse code transmitted by turning off and on their machine in the quantum entanglement of the atom, which is kind of crazy if you think about it. And then I think like the rest, like the beginnings of her investigation into opening tears was to meet her brother. And so she meets him through that. Or her brother. She calls him her brother, but it's actually her in another universe.
Yeah.
That
it's
version
really
of
weird.
Her happens to be male. Yeah. It's deeply interesting. But that's like kind of like the side, like the distant, most distant of side plots in the game.
But the thing is, it is, but it's not.
It's core.
Because that's
very
like
core.
The crux of everything else.
Yeah. So like through that, you kind of get an idea about how it works because... I'm sorry for Tyler because he didn't pick that up, like, which is kind of crazy because some of these audio logs, I'm not sure how a normal person would miss them because I didn't play it like a normal person, so I have no idea what like the main line is through the story.
I think what happened to me was that like I would pick one up, then like I would start it and then like immediately get into a combat scenario, so I wouldn't be able to hear it.
Or like there would be like ambient dialogue that I just wanted to hear and I didn't want to play the audio log over it and everything.
Yeah.
Well, actually, you're right. Ambient dialogue goes under the audio logs. If Elizabeth speaks or Booker speaks, it goes over the audio logs.
Yeah.
Volume, which is kind of.
I probably should have subtitles on, but I don't really like using subtitles in games.
I don't think they go with the subtitles. Do they work with the subtitles?
Audio logs don't, I believe.
Yeah.
Oh, really? You did in the first game.
The crazy thing is, if you go to the menus for audio logs, you can actually read a text version of the audio logs.
Which that's cool.
Plenty useful for after when I was looking through, and we'll get to the discussion later as to why I was looking through them. But Levine is a master. Like I didn't play the original Bioshock, and I don't think I've played any Levine games until this one. And that guy can tell story. That guy can tell stories.
Yeah,
he's a
master storyteller.
He warms the audience up into quantum mechanics wonderfully smoothly. Like, well, Tyler, how many audio logs did you collect by the end? Like, what was your counter at?
I honestly don't know. Probably like 30 something.
Okay.
I picked up anyone that I could find.
Right.
Did
you play on Steam or
Xbox? Tracked?
Yeah, it's an achievement progress, at least for the Steam version.
Yeah, because I got like 60. I think there's 80.
Well, let me check.
I think that's like.
I turned the Steam community or whatever off when I was playing because I just wanted this to be me and this video game.
Yeah. Yep.
I mean, they're like so small, you barely even notice them.
Yeah, and like,
no, it was bothering me.
They don't shine. No, they don't like talking about.
It's not like the
themselves.
Xbox where you get like a little like ding to go with it.
Yeah, I still wanted just to be me and this video game.
Well, this is one of those games that
you
really
buy Bioshock Infinite alone.
Really did draw you in. Into its world and stuff, for better or worse. But we'll get there as we go backwards through the game. So while he talks about that, so did you find the ending confusing at all, Tyler, or did you like get it as soon as you saw it?
No. Well, I was talking to you about this before. It was like as the ending was kind of unfolding, I was starting to put the pieces together in my head about like everything Elizabeth is telling you.
Right.
So by the time like the big reveal at the very end happened, I was like, okay, this makes sense.
Cool.
I was kind of. Thinking that in my head.
Awesome. So we haven't even said it out loud. So Booker is Comstock. That's the
Comstock.
Big reveal at the end.
Yeah.
Well, he's Comstock and Booker at the same time. That goes back to the whole quantum mechanics.
Exactly.
Idea.
Like the way that sounds crazy, and the way it works is by this quantum mechanics stuff that we've just been babbling on about for the first part of the show. What do you guys think of that? Did you? I personally, like Tyler, had inklings of it, but I kind of agree with Jeff Gerspin in that. That reveal at the very end was amazing, but getting there was the incredible part where I was just...
Also, if you just told someone like that line, they probably would have no idea what you're talking about.
Yeah, well, I actually...
Yeah, because I was talking to my boss today at work, and because he asked me, because he knew I was playing through it, and he asked me how it was.
Right.
And I told him like the ending was crazy, and he was like, how do you mean? I'm like, if I told you what it was right now, you probably wouldn't believe me.
Yeah. Or if you did, like... If this was the end of a movie, you'd be pissed. But he spends like 4 hours slowly warming you up to the craziness that's about to happen. So Shinboy, how do you like the ending, just in general? Like,
I really, really enjoyed it because it just goes in like it goes kind of weird in like the last maybe 4 hours or so, but the last like 45 minutes, it just. Information flying like crazy and just gets really weird and out there, and I love it
and fucking great. So it's so hard to talk about because so what part of the ending did you guys what did you find it memorable, and what part of the ending did you guys like particularly what resonated with you, Shinboy?
Probably the part where you figure out who Anna is, and then the hand sort of moves in front of the camera with the AD, and I was like, oh man,
that's her initials. So like,
you see your pinky fingers slowly just like falling
off
the wall.
Off, yeah.
So I just played through that part again, and Ken Levine just made me give a baby away for money. That was so fucked up. Like, his reaction, Booker's reaction while you're doing it, he's like, no, and Elizabeth's just standing there looking at you going,
like, you're gonna do this eventually.
You're gonna do it. And I just felt horror, like, my heart broke when I handed over the child, and you could tell that Booker's reality was just, like, fucking shattering when that was happening, because he could not believe that he would do such a thing.
I mean, it led to him carving her initials into the back of his hand.
I... running down the back streets of wherever it was towards the portal to tackle Comstock and take his baby back.
Tackle yourself and take your own child back from you.
Well, you don't know that yet. I don't think
The thing, this is why I like starting at the ending, because the great thing about this and also the original Bioshock mm-hmm. is that all these things are made so much better looking back on them.
Yeah. Like, just the emotional turmoil of that. Just, and watching, as Tyler said, your kid being pulled away from you through a portal, and she reaches out to you as far as the end. Oh my god. It was like 45 minutes of heartbreak. And then you find out that she's Elizabeth. Oh. Yeah.
I can only imagine how a parent would feel playing this game with like a young child.
Yeah,
they're probably freaking out.
So I think the last part of the end, like, is there anything else? Like, Tyler, what was your most memorable moment? Was that the finger? Or
I really like the part when you're walking around and becomes Bastion.
Oh yeah,
and the floor just starts coming up as you're walking. That was really cool.
That was really cool. I also really
liked how when you're going to the baptism pool again,
yep.
and basically, like, all he's last he wasn't that far. It was afterward when Elizabeth's saying, like, you became Comstock when you were baptized in the beginning of the game.
Yeah,
like that part, I was just like, oh my god, that is amazing. Because, like, you yeah. think about it, like, when you first do it, you're like, oh, what was that about? That was no big deal.
Yeah, because, like, I'm pretty sure it's the same, like, dude baptizing, yeah. too.
It's the same dude baptizing, but I don't think that's necessarily how it worked. Because
I thought it
was. How do we approach this? How do we approach this? Because there's so much time fuckery in this that I don't know where to start. Do you want my version of how that ending breaks down?
Sure.
Probably better than mine, so go ahead.
But before that, I just want to say, also, as a Hindu, not necessarily practicing, but I identify as a Hindu, being asked to get baptized not once, but twice in a video game, that was the most weird thing. Like, for a while, the game opens, and you're walking, well, not necessarily opens, but near the opening of the game, you're walking through a church, and you need to get baptized to enter fucking Colombia. And I was just standing there going, there's no way that asking me to do this. This feels weird. I don't know. I know it's not me.
As a non-practicing, but like you identifying Catholic American, this yep. is not weird at all.
Like, for me, it was just totally, it was definitely outside of my comfort zone, which I appreciate, but was totally freaked out by. And for a long time, I was like staring around. I was like, can I skip this? Is there a way to walk around this dude? And just like, can I just punch him in the face and run in? Or like, you know, something like that? But no, you have to fucking hit F and get baptized. And you do it again at the end of the game. So here's the timeline for the game. And as I understand it, I'll probably miss things because there's just so much to it. But anyway.
Boogerdor is born.
Boogerdor is born. Yeah. He goes through
First, the earth cools. dinosaurs walk the
What's
earth
it called? The like Battle months. Of Something Knee. Wounded Knee?
Wounded Knee.
Yeah. So he goes to the Battle of Wounded Knee. His life goes to shit, essentially. And then he decides, in a moment of crisis, he decides to be born again by baptism. So that is the defining point of the entire game. Because as he joins the Baptist, or as the Baptist grabs him, in half the universes in which there is a Booker DeWitt who undergoes baptism, half of them split off, and he goes through with the baptism and is born again as Fitzroy. I think it was Comstock.
Right? It was Zachary Hale.
Who the
Comstock.
Zachary Hale
Comstock. Fitzroy is a different character.
Fitzroy is a different character. Zachary Hale Comstock.
Weapons manufacturer.
Right. Sorry about that. So Zachary Hale Comstock is
50% of the universe. Fitzroy was the Vox leader.
You're right. That was Fitz was weapons.
Anyway.
So in 50% of the universes, he becomes Comstock. Becomes a born again true believer. Totally changes his identity. Becomes deep into the church. Goes up to the Senate and starts preaching about American values, inverted commas, and starts Columbia. He invests in the twins, or I think it's just the girl at that time.
I think it's just her.
Yeah, the girl at that time, to allow her to create her machine, which then goes on to manipulate quantum mechanics and float a city. That's one side of it. That there'll be more of that, but we'll break that off there. In the other side of it, he stays Booker DeWitt, and he goes on to become a Pinkerton and meets a woman, has a child. The woman dies in childbirth. So skip back over to Comstock. Comstock, it is the fucking Rapture. Sorry, well, not Rapture. The Columbia dude, and through the inventions of the twins, can see the future. So he becomes known as a prophet. He, by doing that, realizes that to continue his dream, because he will die in the near future, because he sees the probabilities of the future through these tears.
It's not also that this is actually like canon. Through use of the machines, he gets cancer.
Oh,
like that's canon.
Oh, it's like, is it cancer or is it is he just
becomes sterile?
Sterile.
It becomes sterile, but I'm pretty sure it was cancer. I don't know. Oh, it's either canon, way. As in I read it on the Bioshock wiki.
Okay, sure, yeah. Sure. The freely editable Bioshock. But sure.
Bioshock.wikia.com or something like that.
So he finds out through the tears and thus probabilities for the future that to continue his dream, his heir or his child needs to be there. So the lamb needs to be there to continue it. But he's sterile by being exposed to the experimentation. So he enlists the twins to go to another universe, to another him who is Booker DeWitt, one who has had a child, and take their child, so his child, for his own, and raise him as his own, or her as his own, and thus give him a lamb for the future. Back to other Booker. Booker is fucking destitute and ex-Pinkerton and huge gambling debts, and he gets a request by a dude named Comstock for his child, and in return he would clear all his debts. Now, why he goes through with it, aside from being a complete fuck up, I don't know. But he decides
he's only got to lose at that point.
Yeah, well, he does by definition because he sells his only thing.
I mean, it's just it just happens. I don't know if we really need to dig deep. That's not the important part here.
Yeah. So okay. He sells his daughter to this Comstock who he doesn't know. But then he changes his mind. So he tracks down the dudes who bought his daughter from him, chases them down through the back streets of the city they're in. I think it's New York. And finds them just as they're going through the portal. This is significant because, as we talked about earlier, as she's going through the portal, as the baby's going through the portal, being pulled by Comstock, who's holding her in his hands, the baby reaches out to him, and the tip of her finger gets cut off by the portal itself. And that's significant because later we find out that because her body, herself, is split across the two universes, that's what gives her her powers.
See, the only part that I guess disagree with is that, do you think that Booker, like him witnessing her being pulled through the portal and everything, like one part of me says he had to be there because her reaching back to him is what cut off her finger.
Right.
But the other part of me is like, as soon as he sees that part of her finger is missing, wouldn't he like think right away, like, oh, this is my daughter? And then sort of.
No, I guess, I think.
No, because it's been 20 years.
Yeah, I guess.
I think what happened was when she gets pulled through the portal, like, it's a completely different dimension now because his daughter's gone.
Mm-hmm.
Because the dimensions basically met each other.
Yep.
Mm-hmm. So Booker doesn't remember any of that. That's why whenever his nose bleeds, he's trying to remember something, but he can't because it's a different dimension.
Can I just say as a side note?
Sure.
That I thought it was really funny that someone said because of that, they gave the game 4.5 out of 5.
Wait, because of what?
Because of
five
Elizabeth's
fingers,
hand.
4.5.
Oh, wow.
Terrible joke. Terrible joke. So to continue the timeline, 20 years later, so Comstock has Anna, Booker's child, renames her Elizabeth, puts her in the tower because of her weird powers, and raises her in seclusion, and gives her Songbird, who he finds through the portals of the twins, as a protector.
Are you sure he finds them? Because if you look around the game, there are blueprints.
Well, he got, I think it was the weapons dealer, so the Fitzroy. No, not Fitzroy, the Vox. Who the fuck is he? The guy who manufactures.
Dude?
No, the guy who manufactures all everything.
Fink?
The industrialist. Fink, yeah. Fink, I think he builds. Yeah, he finds like designs or something. He finds technology.
Yeah.
I think it's just technology, like definitionless technology through the portals, because he uses the portals to listen to music. And that's why you get like the Beach Boys and shit back in the 1917, yeah, when that music was in the 60s.
Yeah, there was some CCR in there.
Yeah, exactly.
And Cyndi Lauper at one point. Girls want to have fun.
Absolutely. So like because of that, he uses it for like random shit. So he finds technology. Part of that allows him to develop Songbird, who he puts in as a protector for Elizabeth. So switch over to Booker. Booker is destitute, even worse now. He's in depression. 20 years later, a portal opens up in his living room to a dude on a beach who says that he will allow him and Anna to be together again. And he goes to the portal. From there, events similar to what happened in the game progress, but Booker dies at the hands of Songbird.
Yeah, the only thing that bothers me is, like, you mentioned him going through the portal, like, mm-hmm. the dude offered him. There was that whole moment where they're sort of dragging you as you're, like, unconscious.
Yeah.
How does that factor
in? So I'm about to get there. So okay. Booker goes in, goes through the many trials of Columbia. And at the very end, before he can save Elizabeth proper, he dies at the hands of Songbird. That happens again 120 times with very slight deviations.
Wait, where did you figure this out from?
So at the start of the game, where the twins first approach you, they have mm-hmm. they ask you if you want to get heads or tails, right? And yeah. the character, I don't think this is a choice, automatically hits heads.
You can pick.
You can choose.
You can choose, but it ends up on heads.
Yeah. Yeah. Sorry. So, and it's always heads. And if when he turns around, you can see the tallies on his back.
Oh, okay. Yes.
Those are actually tallies off how many times he's gone through it. Also, when you first enter the game, the code you type into at the watchtower. So not the watchtower. The lighthouse is 122. And their tally is at 121. Like, you are the 122nd Booker.
Oh, okay, yes, that makes sense.
The chain.
So there's shitloads. So there's 121 Bookers before you, and they all died by various things. But primarily, the ones that closest to the end died because of Songbird.
I assume it would be like right at the very end. You know, when Elizabeth opens the tear, a Songbird is about to kill you. I assume it's then.
Or like as you're crossing the bridge to whatever, and Songbird picks her up or whatever.
Yes. Okay.
Yeah. Like at some point, you die by Songbird, and finally your Booker happens. So what happens is those realities are collapsing, and when he first goes through the portal into the other dimension, that's why he's getting like huge amounts of like temporal dissonance, but mm-hmm. because those other realities are collapsing on him, because he's leaving one reality and people are dying, his versions of himself are dying in the future and collapsing on mm-hmm. him. Also, potentially, it could just be a result of going through in the first place, because if you listen to one of the audio logs, the moment her brother, the twins' brother, the boy of the twins, comes yeah. through, he's immediately met with psychological dissonance as well. So it could just be a side effect. Yeah.
And there's two instances of you in this one world, and that's kind of weird.
And that could be very much part of it as well. Right? It's very possible that because the other Booker is also in your world, you're both mm-hmm. receiving dissonance, and that's why you forget that you ever had a kid in the first place. At the end of the game, like, you forget Anna. You forget giving away Anna because the Comstock Booker never did that. So yeah, then the game happens.
Yeah. Okay, then the game happens.
Then there's Unreal Engine 3,
uh-huh.
splash screen.
Yep,
a lot
exactly.
of bloom.
And then
lots of stuttering.
Plays best on AMD.
The Beach Boys. V-Sync. The Beach Boys happens. You're forced to get
Force V-Sync through
twice.
Drivers.
Yeah, that's right.
You turn sensitivity all the way down, because what the fuck?
Yeah.
You turned FOV slider all the way up.
Also, you can't disable auto aim. That annoyed me so much.
Wait, there was auto aim?
Unlock on.
Yeah, I went in the INI files, turned all of them to false, and it still had auto aim.
Yeah, when you're near someone and you go into iron sights, you auto aim a little.
I didn't even notice that.
I never went to iron sights.
Maybe that's turned
off. It defaults to off.
Oh,
but
maybe.
But you can't go in the main options and turn it off.
Right. Oh, it defaults to off?
On higher difficulties, I think.
Oh, cool.
Okay, because I was playing on hard, so there you go.
Yeah, there you go. Well, for me, I don't like the iron sights on the carbine, but the carbine is my favorite gun.
Oh, they're so good.
Anyway. Yeah, so that happens. You get to the end of the game, and essentially what is happening there is, as you're going up to save Elizabeth, when you usually would have died by a songbird, you survived because she intervened. You cross the bridge, and then you meet, as you're waking your way up to the experimentation facility, which is brainwashing her into believing to the same shit as Comstock believes, and thus becoming the lamb as he prophesied. The future Elizabeth comes back for the first time in the 122 tries. Future Elizabeth comes back and pulls Booker forward and gives him the password, or essentially, to unlocking control over Birdman.
Songbird.
With the car.
Can I say that it was genius what that was?
Yeah, C-A-G-E. Never would have thought of it. Oh my God.
Because I was listening back, you know, to like even the very first one, you first meet Elizabeth in her room. If you listen to the thing there, that is C-A-G-E.
Really? Nice.
I mean, that's what I mean by these things are better that you look back at them. Because
yeah.
I know you didn't play Bioshock, and we're going to spoil the original Bioshock right now.
So I don't know instruments, so yeah.
we're going to spoil the original Bioshock right now, too.
Sure, go ahead.
The whole thing with that was...
that final boss.
Oh, that final boss was dumb. But anyway, the whole thing with that is the phrase, "Would you kindly?" Which if you get to Andrew Ryan, who's like the main baddie for most of the game, you get to his office, there's a big wall that says, "Would you kindly?"
Right, it's apparently like a brainwash like thing.
It's a trigger phrase.
Yeah.
And if you go back and you listen to all of the dialogue in the game leading up to that point, the dude who's quote-unquote guiding and helping you is using that phrase in his dialogue.
Mm-hmm. And it sounds like he's just
every
being
time
like
that
nice,
happens, like you get like your brain starts like...
Yeah, playing. Like you as the player don't even notice until you look back on it and you're like, holy shit.
Yeah.
And the same thing here.
Yeah, the twist here is the entire time, C-A-G-E, that's what controls Songbird.
And I was like, wait, Songbird, that name, it makes sense.
Yeah.
It's controlled by a song.
Like, yeah.
Multiple
levels of mind
blowing.
Well, they said early on that a song plays in order to like call it, because like one of the statues played the song, and then
that's what
the
I mean,
songbird
but, like, those,
showed
those
up.
Statues,
but you didn't know like what the actual notes were.
I mean, like... I'm sure if someone was a more astute music listener than I, they would know instantly. I just sort of listened back and noticed that the notes matched.
That's cool.
It's not like I heard it and went, "Oh, that's a C." No, I just knew that they matched.
Okay, right. Yeah, I didn't understand.
C minor.
It's C sharp.
So, yeah, you meet Comstock on his airship. And he's like, "Tell her what happens to your..." Wait, at what point do you start nosebleeding? You start nosebleeding...
There's a few different points.
Yeah, because...
I think it's after the second like major tear through time.
So I thought so, but if you watch... So just to be clear, when you're opening tears, just in case you don't remember somehow, when you go through it, Booker experiences a nosebleed. This is very significant because... They pointed out in game, like, the people you killed in your universe, when you go over to the Terrid universe, are experiencing, like mental dissonance and nosebleeds. When I watched the quick look after I finished the game, because I waited till after, and you first enter fucking Columbia, you're going up an elevator before you've ever met Elizabeth, and Comstock gives you a speech as you're going up an elevator about how you're a dickhead, you get a nosebleed.
Really?
You get a nosebleed, and I completely forgot that
like
happened.
Like hand in front of camera.
Yeah, hand in front of the camera, wipes it away, blood in his hands, full on end of game nosebleed happens near the start of the game.
See, that's what I mean. These things are better when looked back upon.
Yeah, so that's my printer. So yeah, like you totally get nosebleeds, and that's indicating that it's pretty difficult to say. It's either that you're remembering something, or you're suppressing something, or there's some form of psychological dissonance created by version of dying.
I think it's most likely because you were talking to a different version of yourself.
Yeah.
Yeah, and like your mind couldn't
trying to like give yourself a message. There's like a Star Trek Next Generation episode about this where they like destroy another ship and then they get set back into like an infinite loop and they keep trying to like send messages to their future selves.
Right.
And eventually they get out of it and they find out like they've been in this loop for like over 2 weeks.
Man. So,
I think what happens is like, I think most likely what happens is that your brain is arguing with itself.
Yeah.
Meaning that
absolutely
you are trying to give yourself like, someone else is trying to force their opinions on you, but that other person is you.
Mm-hmm.
So your brain doesn't know what to do.
That could be the case because like if you walk near the dudes who are having like who are freaking out that way, they're almost invariably like going, there's two me's inside me. I don't know which I am. There's two voices.
Like both dead and alive.
Yeah. And it's disagreeing with me, but that's not me. Like you're getting that. The hard argument against that though is the twins don't have that problem. Like they finish each other's sentences
because they are in two separate bodies,
and they like transcend like, all dimensions. Basically,
you and you and Comstock are. Oh yeah, perhaps it's because they're different enough to not have that problem. So they are from two completely different universes.
Because it's not like say the sister lived her life and suddenly decided she wanted to be male and became the brother.
It was actually like sometimes.
That's what I mean. That's what I mean. It's not like someone.
Yeah,
they are different people who happen to be of the same being and met.
Yeah.
As in like DeWitt is Comstock. Like they're one and the same, just at different points in their life.
Yeah. So what was I going to say? Yeah, so you meet Comstock at the end. You
find around yourself.
You finally get to him in like a cool... One of the coolest end bosses, I guess, in my opinion, because you could argue against that because it's not, you can't make a decision. It's not interactive, but just walking up to the end boss dude and just slamming his fucking head against a stone fountain.
You have to press like interrupt before you do that.
Oh yeah, it's so true. Yeah, you do hit F.
There is some interaction involved.
But yeah, he just like tell her about her finger and then you get a nosebleed and you're like, what the fuck are you talking about? And then you kill his ass. And that was,
I think,
that was
one of my favorite,
cool.
One of my favorite parts about that room, which I think is symbolic of the whole game and the whole city of Columbia, is you walk in and it's this beautiful room with all these trees and grass. But the thing is, you go upstairs in that room and you look down and you can just see it's all a set, basically.
Just a full-on set with like a backdrop and everything. You walk behind the backdrop.
I think that was pretty well done. That was pretty symbolic of the whole thing.
Man, yeah, absolutely. Show. So at that point, did you guys suspect what the fuck was going on? I was even more confused after he said he asked me what happened to her finger. And I was just like, what are you talking about?
Like, why would I know?
Yeah, and Booker says as well. He's like, I just thought it was something you had since you were born or something. And then... Yeah, that's how I felt. So you get there, you get to the end, you fight the Vox Populi, the last couple waves of the Vox Populi, and then you get control of Songbird and you destroy the tower. You're destroying Elizabeth's old home, which had that siphon, which was sucking her power away from her, trying to drain her of all her power, but doesn't work, and using that power, I think, in some sideways ways, like to power What's-His-Face's inventions and stuff. And give him music. What's the guy's name again?
Fink.
Yeah. Fuck. Never remember his name.
Like four letters.
So, yeah. After all that, it's kind of it's just crazy downhill because Super Liz happens. When she gets white hair, she becomes Dante. Shinboy, do you want to elaborate what happens after here? Someone just knocked on my door.
Because I don't really remember. Okay, so hold on. Where does Todd? Do you remember that tear that she opens? Where does that tear take you?
That takes you to Rapture.
Okay. Yes. Okay. So that takes you to Rapture, and then you're walking around Rapture, and Elizabeth is just like, "Oh, this. Oh, I know where this is. Not so much that it's Rapture, but that it's a window.
It's like one of the lighthouses.
Not quite yet, but you don't know that yet.
Well, she knows she's taking you there.
Yeah, but I mean, like, you as the player don't know that yet.
Well, you don't know what's going on at that point.
It's crazy because her level. I don't want to say power level, but she just like level. Songbird is flying towards you because you what a dumbass. He literally drops the flute or whatever it is, like the accordion or what mouth accordion.
No, you rip it out of the statue in the cabin.
No, I mean at the end, just before what happens is you just fought Vox Populi and you totally drop the thing, don't you?
It's because it stopped working. If you listen to the dialogue, he's like, oh, I lost control over him. It stopped working or something.
Oh,
like
really?
That.
I just thought he dropped it and he's like, oh shit, I lost the flute. I can't control him anymore is how I...
No. You can't control him because it stopped working.
Oh, maybe it was powered by the tower. Anyway.
Yeah. Who knows?
Yeah, who knows? So her hair goes white and then Songbird's like trying to attack you and she just waves her hand and a fucking gigantic tear opens, which is like this... size of your screen, you cannot see the edges of it, and he just disappears. You're brought into rapture, and you just watch him die behind a huge pane of glass. Like just,
I think my favorite part of that scene was that he dies like sort of happy, if you look at it, because
his eyes are yellow and green. Yeah,
and then his eyes turn green, and he's like, "Okay, I'm okay with this."
What do you think, Tyler? What do you think of the relationship between Elizabeth and Songbird?
I was kind of getting mixed messages from Elizabeth because she kept saying like, oh, I don't want to go back there. It was like horrible. It was torture.
Yeah.
But then whenever she saw the songbird, she was kind of like, not only happy, but she didn't want anything bad to happen to him. And he didn't want him to do anything bad to Booker.
Cause like if you listen though, cause she talks about like songbird is basically the only other, I guess you can call it living thing that she saw for like her whole life, basically.
Yeah. 17 years or something.
Hmm.
The crazy thing is, like, if you, like, when you first, like, look at her bedroom, whatever, there's, like, little pictures in, like, a kid's kind of quality of Songbird on her wall. Like, just drawings made by her of Songbird.
Yeah. Also, in the ultimate crazy when you look back on it moment, if you go back to one of the very first trailers where it shows that scene where you first meet Elizabeth and she's, like, throwing books at you or whatever.
Yeah.
One of the books she throws at you is, like... something along the lines of like principles of quantum mechanics,
yeah, totally,
or something like that.
Yeah. Absolutely. And as is the way of Bioshock Infinite, if you look along the bookshelves, there's a couple of copies of that book. Anyway, so you're teleported to Rapture, as we said at the start of the fucking episode. That was fucking insane. As a person who didn't play Bioshock 1, even I thought it was like, holy cow, this is crazy. And the sad thing was, before the game opened, like before the game came out, I thought it was spoiled because some dickhead made a post in the forums, which was like, which is so close to the actual ending. So it kind of terrified me all the way up until the end, which was like, Elizabeth is your daughter. You turn out to be Comstock, and Comstock is no, or it's like you turn out to be Andrew Ryan. No, he's like, you turn out to be Andrew Ryan.
Oh my god, that'd be amazing.
And Elizabeth kills you at the end. I'm like, what? What the fuck? So when
similar to that happened to me with the original Bioshock, where there was like a forum post where someone said that like you were born in Rapture and that Andrew Ryan was your father.
Oh wow!
So like that bothered me the whole time, but then I didn't know the whole like "would you kindly" part. So that I didn't have that spoiled for me at least.
There you go. And so well, thankfully this guy was fucking wrong, and but I was terrified when I got it because this whole time, like literally like 97% of the game or some shit, you never see Rapture. Like Rapture doesn't come into it. And it's only there
it doesn't exist yet, technically.
And it's only there for like 15, 20 seconds of the game.
I was thinking about this, the fact that it takes place before the original Bioshock. Do you think that was a result of Bioshock 2? Since that takes place after the first game, and
who played Bioshock 2?
Bioshock 2. I didn't play Bioshock 2.
But I'm saying, do you think they might have wanted to set this game after Bioshock, but then since Bioshock 2 happens, like, we can't do anything that would contradict that, so let's make it a prequel?
I don't know.
No, I don't think so.
I think Levine is more of, like, the world is really important to him, so I think he really wanted to capture that turn
because
of the century.
That turn of the century was, like, height of the World's Fair, and because Columbia very much seems like a giant World's Fair, so I think that's what he was going for. I think the time of Bioshock being 1960 was completely irrelevant to that decision.
I
guess in my
opinion. Yeah, you're probably right. He wasn't like setting a marker and going, I shouldn't be near there. He just picked a place and went for it. So, and that turned to be, turned out to be 20th century. Or
something else I was thinking about, I was talking to Shinboy about this before. Were you thinking at all when you first get in Colombia how anyone is able to breathe because of how thin the air must be?
That is a fantastic point. I did not think of it at the time.
No. It makes sense because you can levitate the particles and they can breathe. It makes perfect sense, actually.
Sure.
Yeah, but they don't tell you that in the beginning. So I'm like, when I'm walking around, it's like, wait, how's anybody
It makes sense looking back on it.
And like run around. Yeah, it makes sense now. I just thought it was funny when we first get there.
I completely didn't think of that. And I think that's it. I think it's a valid point because no matter how much you levitate air, there are things called like I can't believe I've forgotten what they're called. Essentially, huge air currents that travel at that altitude that would blow away anything you've got. No matter what is trying to hold your air down, it's got nothing.
Unless you like theoretically lock it there
somehow. Anyway, so aside from mystical force fields,
the things are free moving because the buildings can move around, but they are still locked.
Somehow, yeah.
In a sense.
By quantum.
Yes.
So
quantum mechanics, the answers for everything.
Any questions about the quote-unquote realism of this, I'm just going to answer with quantum mechanics, and that's the answer.
It's the magic of this game. Well, did they ever explain what vigors were, like how that worked?
Not plasmids.
Yes, they're beverages.
Yeah, but like... Did they ever say quantum mechanics or some shit with those as well? Because that was just magic. That's all I got from that.
In the original Bioshock, they messed with your genetic code.
Right.
I don't know what they did here. I don't think they ever really explained it, no.
Probably something similar. But...
Yeah.
Yeah. Magic, whatever. Then Sea of Doors happens. So does it cut straight to you being on the boat, or do you just end up in the Sea of Doors? I forget. Yeah, you're on the boat. You're like, I think you're on the boat, don't you? Because you walk into the lighthouse, and she's like,
No. The way it works is you go into the bathysphere, right? And it takes you to the lighthouse from the first Bioshock.
Right.
And then you open that door, and it opens up to the sea of lighthouses.
Yeah, exactly. So like, you walk up to the first door, and she's like, there's a key in my hand, which is kind of a shitty line. Like, it was always there. Fuck off. But sure. And then you unlock the
quantum
door.
Quantum mechanics. You can summon the
through,
key.
And then you see all the lighthouses. And that was... And when she said like all the stars were gates or whatever, or tears, I was just like, mind expanding at a large, like, extreme rate. Holy
just
shit.
Just that mind-blown gif everywhere.
It's like, what is happening? And then the slow reveal happens. Like we talked about this top of the show, the last 30 minutes of that game, just the slow breaking down of like going back in time and just showing you visions of what your decisions have been in the past as Booker and as Comstock. And
yeah, because like I was kind of confused as to like, why did they choose Infinite as the subtitle?
Yeah.
And then there I was like, oh.
So as Bioshock guys?
Yeah, I was more like, why is it called Bioshock?
How'd you guys... Because
I know it's to sell more copies, obviously. But...
No, that's not... Because if you listen to Ken Levine talk, and Ken Levine is one of my favorite... Like, I could listen to him talk about anything.
Anything. The guy is amazing.
We listened to him talk.
Yeah, we did. But like...
One of our friends fell asleep.
He sees Bioshock as a theme.
Right.
As in, I don't know really how to explain it. I guess the game sort of explained it. Where
how do you feel about Bioshock, that? Like, there's always a lighthouse. There's always a man. There's always
Bioshock
a girl.
To Ken Levine is a series of constants and variables.
High five! High five! You got to use the phrase in the podcast about the thing.
I mean, joking and getting to use that line aside, I honestly believe that's what he sees.
Yeah.
A Bioshock game has these constants that are always going to be there. I think now that the lighthouse is a constant.
I love that.
The protector and the guardian and the protected are a constant.
Yep. And there's always a man. There's always the dude who you are, essentially.
Yep. And there's always like the larger than life figure that you're trying to take down. I don't know if that's really.
She didn't name that. Like the others she actually named as constants was the lighthouse, the protector, the protected, or I think she says the girl. I'm not sure. Mm-hmm. And then the man who's here.
Yeah.
So. Well, now that all that stuff is kind of blown wide open, like, where do they go from here? Like, what do you think the next game is going to be about?
Because, like,
the big reveal has already happened.
I hate to break it to you, but it's going to open with a lighthouse, and then something amazing is going to happen. and you could end up being a dude, probably.
Because if you listen to the interview with Jeff on Giant Bomb, I'm not sure that he wants to do another one.
That's what I'm saying. It's like, you can't really go anywhere further from here, because if the next game starts you going to the lighthouse, you're like, oh, wait, I already know.
Like, I honestly would not be surprised if this is Ken Levine's last major game.
I think
I can see that.
Because we're getting ahead of ourselves, but I think in that case, I think Ken Levine, especially with a lot of like the pre-release response and conflicting with the NDAs, of course, but like a lot of the people he was talking to, like the press or whatever, was asking him continuous questions as to like whether he's worried it would resonate, whether he's worried about the things he's addressing in the game.
Aside from the setting, talking about resonating, the themes in this game make it probably one of the most modern games to come out in the last few years.
I 100% agree. Like, just the fact that throughout the whole game, you're fighting women as well as men. Like, the enemies are women, too.
The leader of the Vox Populi is a woman.
Yeah.
Not just that. Woman. Like, it's dealing with race issues, religion issues. Mm-hmm. Religion's role in government, science versus religion, all of these like hot
poverty, which issues. Is becoming more and more of a thing.
Yeah.
Everyone was complaining before this game was coming out about all the like the religious overtones.
Yeah, exactly. Being lost in debt.
War between the classes, everything like that. Like, these are relevant issues.
And just the stuff that'll always be relevant, like fatherhood, motherhood, like shit like that.
This game takes place 100 years ago. It's still like fairly modern.
Yeah,
that's absolutely. What I mean. Like, setting aside, it's probably the most modern game to come out in the last few years.
Yeah, exactly. It's
and this is completely mechanics aside.
Mm-hmm. And so he was getting all this shit by like from every angle, all the way. Like, people were bitching at him about the cover of his fucking game. Like, he couldn't do anything right before the game came out. People were like, "Is the game in trouble?" Like, even I was like, "I don't know, man. They went quiet for a long time. I'm kind of worried."
I was being cautiously optimistic.
Yeah.
I was like, this game's never coming out.
And
I'm still not convinced it'll come out.
All of that shit totally wore him down to the point where I bet he was just like, I'm not sure if I want to do this again. People are jerks. Like, he was saying to GameSpot, he thinks cynicism might kill the industry. And I'm totally with him.
I agree too.
Yeah. And so, but I think, like, personally, and obviously it's his choice to make, but I think the insanely positive response to this game will inspire him to make another one. I think he's fine.
I mean, I can see that. I mean, I kind of hope like this is the end, because this is really a good note to end on.
Oh yeah, absolutely.
It kind of just wraps, and also, like, wraps everything up so nicely.
So
the cat's out of the bag here with the formula. I don't want to call it the formula of the series formula. Because
the constants.
The constants we know. So it's kind of hard to make another one when the constants are already known.
Yeah.
If you know what I mean?
The fact that you know that there are constants.
Because, like, when I saw the beginning of this game, like, they showed, like, the first 5 minutes of Bioshock Infinite in the video, and it's like, you going up to the lighthouse. And I was like, that's a cool nod to the first Bioshock. That's
kind of
cool.
I honestly thought it was the same lighthouse. Just like
no, it's a different one.
Hmm.
No, but, like, I was like, that's a cool nod to the first game. People who play the first game will think that's cool, and then people who didn't will just, you know, it'll be the beginning of this game. But it turns out that's actually, like, an integral part.
Yeah. It's always lighthouse.
This whole overarching thing.
Which I found, fascinating. And as a person who didn't play the first Bioshock, maybe it resonated with me just as much. Well, not, I couldn't have resonated with me just as much, but it definitely resonated with me. It was like, holy cow, this guy has not only, he hasn't just made a world, he's made a universe with this game, which is
multiple,
which
even.
Is kind of crazy.
Infinite universes.
So, her laying out the fact that there's things that are constant throughout all universes, then going into, but that's a kind of an aside, because in the end that only slightly matters to the core concept of the core plot of the game, because in the end there's only two people who matter, which is Comstock and, well, three: Comstock, Elizabeth, and Booker. And like, the game is deeply personal, like especially between Booker and Elizabeth. It's all about Booker and Elizabeth. So all this stuff is a fantastic window dressing. If they hadn't nailed it with you walking through, like her revealing this to you, telling you about multiple universes, then going through a door to one of the lighthouses and hearing that music, the hymn, which is "Will the Circle Be Broken?" the baptism music, and being surrounded by those people and seeing the priest there, and just, and the holy what the fuck moment of that is like, why am I here? You were just talking about killing Comstock in his cradle. And she
but like, I think like the moment, because there's a moment where for Elizabeth, it all just clicks instantly.
Yeah.
And I think once that happens and she starts explaining it to you, that like little, I guess it's pretty short. It's only like 5-10 minutes.
Yeah.
Where you could tell that she really gets what's going on.
I see all the doors.
Probably one of my favorite little stretches of video game like ever.
Yeah.
Yeah, because she gets all her powers back when the thing is destroyed.
Explodes, yeah.
It's pretty much once you get to Rapture and she recognizes what it is, and you're like, "Well, what is this place?" And she's like, "It's a window," and you can tell that she knows what's going on, but you still don't.
Yeah.
It's like one of the most like exciting moments.
Absolutely. The ending of this game, because it's not 5 minutes of mind blowing. It's just, it's like half an hour. It's like a full half hour orgasm. you're just sitting there being mind raped by this game and loving it the whole time.
I was talking to Revan when he finished it, but before I finished it, and I was just like, sum up how you feel about it in like one sentence. Mm-hmm. And he was just like, they could teach an entire college course on the ending of this game.
And I can see where he's coming from, because like, what do you guys think of, so you go through that process, you go through the first baptism or iteration of the baptism and the ending sequence, and he's like, why are we doing that? Why are we looking at my past? We're looking for Comstock. And she's like, Comstock was here. And that's when I started piecing it, like, finally, after the game beating me over the head with it, I was like, oh, okay, so you're Comstock. And
I have the same feeling.
Yeah.
It was that same scene where, you know, all the other Elizabeths are showing up and they're just like reborn as Booker DeWitt or Zachary Hale Comstock.
Yeah.
And I was like, oh, that makes sense now that I think about it.
Yeah.
And then you drown yourself.
Yes. Yeah, so, well, they drown you.
And then they all disappear.
Yeah.
And then it's fun.
And then just fucking irrational games. And I was
except
like,
one.
Fuck
one,
the, yeah, one yeah, did one, survive.
The quote unquote real Elizabeth, the one that was with you for the whole game, stays.
Well, not her as well, because it is her and it isn't her, because I'm not sure if you guys remember, but as soon as, because I just played it, so I don't know. As soon as he enters that scene and he enters the second, baptism with only the priest there and no crowd, and he's like, where the fuck? And he turns around and it's Elizabeth. And you recognize her as the same Elizabeth as you've been playing with for the rest of the game. But he doesn't. The character doesn't. He's just like, who are you? And then fucking craziness happens and she pushes you under the water. And you watch through the eyes of your character as you drown.
No, my point is that like after you drown and all the Elizabeths like
yeah, just the one remaining,
the
right?
The one remains. That's what I mean. Yeah. The one that you had been with the whole time.
We have no idea. Because so, did you guys wait it out and see the post-credit sequence?
Of course, and goddamn it, and goddamn it,
and goddamn. So here's where the multiple universes argument begins, and I've been discussing this on Giant Bomb's forums pretty much all day, and thankfully it's been a mellow discussion of just polite disagreement between many individuals, but.
It's not a flame war yet.
The level of what's getting there. The level of disagreement and complexity of this ending is astounding. So, after the credits,
you know what this reminds me of? Like almost exactly.
Shoot.
Do you guys remember when Inception came out?
Yes.
The ending, you're right. With the top.
Absolutely, you're right. Is she dreaming? It's perfect. Yeah, this is exactly
Christopher Nolan came out and said that it wasn't a dream.
No, he has not confirmed either. Or
I'm pretty sure that.
No, because we've had this discussion before where you said he didn't, and I fucking looked it up.
Like, and very recently, he said it again. You can look it up again. Go ahead.
It'll be in the show notes.
You are in first person. You wake up in Booker's office. I believe on the desk is I think it's like 1890 like
something.
Yeah.
Like when it was. Born,
yeah, it's near when Elizabeth is born. I didn't actually catch that first time,
which means like Booker is like 18 because according to the wiki, he's born like 1875 or something. Which I guess back then,
but I mean, having a kid like 18, 19, not a big deal
back then,
back in the day,
back then.
And you get up and you hear the like, it's not a jingle, it's a jingle, whatever you want to call it, from the bedroom, and you open the door, and they fucking black screen it when you open the door, because yep. God damn it. So that's where the multiple universe thing is the fact, because the idea is there are infinite universes, right, in the world of Bioshock Infinite. In some of them, Booker went, so there was a junction point in his life in some of the universes. In some of the versions of Booker, he was in a terrible situation and decided to get a baptism to restart his life. Mm-hmm. Of those, that subset of the entirety of the universe of Booker DeWitt, those are the ones that branched off into the game we played Booker, the 121 versions of him, and the many versions of Comstock. But that is only a subset of the entire universe, because how it
but
works.
The thing is, it's technically a subset, mm-hmm. but it's still technically infinite.
Yeah, exactly. Because how it works in this game, because, well, the thing about infinity, just people don't know, is it's a mathematical construct. It's not a number.
It's not a number. It's a concept.
Yeah, you can't square infinity. There's no such thing as infinity squared. There's no such thing as infinity plus one. You can infinitely
regardless
add
of what
and infinitely subtract.
You.
Yeah, exactly. Regardless what Thurb says, you can infinitely add and infinitely.
No, I mean, like third graders, because like, you know, I'm going to do this times infinity. Oh, yeah. Well, I'm going to do it times infinity plus one.
Exactly. And I think most people don't progress beyond a third grade understanding of what infinity is. Sadly. because
sick burns.
You cannot divide infinity. You cannot add. Well, you can infinitely divide. You can infinitely add. And you can do whatever the fuck you want to
basically,
infinity. It stays infinity.
If you spend a day trying to wrap your mind around the concept of infinity, the next day you're going to be extremely depressed.
Well, that, and you won't be able to, because it is literally a concept that's pretty much made such that we cannot understand it. It's infinite. So that's the deep. Idea is there's an infinite amount of Bookers who progress past the point, the junction point in his life, where he decides to get a baptism. The idea behind the ending is it's actually a different Booker, a Booker who never decided to get a baptism in the first place, who just lived a shitty life and as a single father of his kid. That's what the post-credit sequence is. There's an infinite amount of universes where Booker's wife survived the childbirth and they lived a happy life together. There's a sad life together, and an infinite amount of
See, I see it differently, because by being drowned, mm-hmm. you pretty much render all of the events of the game null and void. Like, they no longer exist.
That's exactly
Columbia
right.
never existed.
So that's what I'm trying to say, because this is the argument. Some people believe mm-hmm. that the Columbia – so when you go back in time to where he drowns himself, that is mm-hmm. only one Booker DeWitt in one version of the universe – who drowns himself, and it only affects that stream and the consequences from that stream, right?
Mm-hmm.
This is distinctly different from there only being one Booker in the entirety of the universe,
only one.
And mm-hmm. him spawning from that point onwards the Comstock and Booker struggle.
See, that's what makes sense, because the way I see it is like, you're drowning yourself in what I guess I've been calling to myself like your home universe.
Mm-hmm. Sure.
And because that is happening, it can't branch off anywhere.
Yeah. You're canceling off the events of the game. You're canceling off.
Basically, you're basically hitting stop and then rewinding mm-hmm. back to I guess, the point after the credits.
Exactly. Because
yeah, you killed yourself and Comstock. So mm-hmm. since Comstock's gone, there's no Columbia anymore.
There's no Columbia. Yeah. There's no Elizabeth technically, because mm-hmm. she's still Anna.
Yeah.
Yeah.
And so, well, but you're dead. So what happens at the end is your mind then collapses upon another Booker who just never went to the baptism in the first place. Never spawned Columbia. Mm-hmm. Just lives with his kid. But there's a contingent of the audience who thinks there is actually no time travel in this game.
Those people are just wrong.
Yeah.
What do they mean exactly?
So that's what I said earlier. So the difference between our two theories are, one set of thinking is that there are an infinite amount of Bookers who all decided to get a baptism and spawned off an infinite amount of events such as Columbia. The other side of theory believes in junction points in reality, which is kind of stated by the twins at some point. I swear it was, which was,
yeah,
which
I remember
is
hearing that phrase.
That at one point in one version of Booker, he decided to get a baptism, and that's who you go back to and drown.
See, that's what I believe.
Yeah. That's
yeah, that makes more sense because it doesn't make sense if he never got baptized, because once you enter Columbia, you get baptized.
Oh, yeah.
So
yeah.
You would have got baptized either way.
See, mm-hmm. that makes sense. And it also seems like that's what the game wants you to believe. Because like you said, I do recall hearing the
junctures.
I think it was in one of the audio logs.
Yeah,
about
one of the audio
logs. Juncture points.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. And
that's what I think one of the best and worst parts about this game is that so much – it's not really core to the story from the 12 mm-hmm. hours that is Bioshock Infinite or however long it took you to play it.
14.
I mean, it's 9.5, actually.
Fair enough. But my point is, like, it's not important to that, but in order to understand the greater scheme behind it is important.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
And I think it's both good and terrible that's hidden away in audio logs.
Yeah, but even then, it's still better than the original Bioshock, because
the
original
whole
Bioshock
game is audio logs and
yeah,
radio.
Like, that was the entire game. Mm. But at least in Infinite, you can get the main story from Elizabeth telling it to you.
At the very end, which
also
is fantastic.
Not non-silent protagonist, good choice.
Damn straight.
Yeah,
well, damn straight. Because
technically, the guy from the first game wasn't silent because he had like two lines like at the very beginning. They never speaks again.
The point where it really clicked was like when you go back and you're on the boat,
and you're like, "I'm sorry, I gave you away. I gave you away." That part, because
the part where you're like right rowing to the lighthouse again, mm-hmm. and then you realize that the people rowing are the Lucettes.
Yeah,
and I was like, "Oh, wait, this is happening again." This is an infinite loop.
Yeah.
Bioshock Infinite. I get it.
And if you think about what they're saying, it was like, he's not rowing. And he's like, and she's like, yeah, he's not rowing. He's like, no, he never rows. And so
they've done this a million times already.
Yeah, they've done it 121 times. They've been establishing the constants and the variables.
Yeah, and like the thing is
that
they said that right at the beginning of the game.
And you're just wondering, like, what the fuck is wrong with these people? They didn't give me the option to row, the bastards. And then it's like it's just, it's incredible. So I guess I'm happy neither of you believe in the other version of the argument where
bullshit theory,
where it only stopped one Columbia and not infinite other Columbias. Because
what I think what happened was the Reapers were controlling you the whole time. Like, you were making decisions.
You got to talk to Sovereign at the end of the first game, at the end of the first Bioshock.
Fuck those guys too. I hate
that
theory.
So you actually don't really understand this.
No, I don't.
I hate that. Do you believe that theory? Because I hate that theory. I think it's the dumbest theory.
That's BS.
What, the all story?
No.
People believe that he was... Exactly. So this, why am I even explaining
it? We won't talk about it in detail.
This is not the Mass Effect 3 spoiler cast.
So that was the ending. And I thought, for one, the ending was one of the best endings to a video game. In fact, I would say it's up there with The Usual Suspects as a movie, and that's saying a lot about a video game in that this ending was that good.
I think the most impressive part in all this is not so much the story,
mm-hmm.
but how it's so expertly told in a medium where you don't have control over the main character.
What do you mean?
If you know what I mean. Like, players are like Ken Levine always likes to say, players are unpredictable.
Mm-hmm.
So I think it's amazing that they tell the story, not so much the story that they're telling, but the way that they tell it.
Yeah.
I agree so far,
people,
but the last part I didn't get. What do you mean?
To people that they don't know what they're going to do as they're receiving this information.
Yeah, because essentially crafted a story that was entirely was intrinsic to your character, but entirely independent of your actions within the video game.
Yeah, it ties back to that line where it's like, you can make whatever choice you want, but in the end, we get the same result.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Which I thought was
funny, because like, I was standing there like at one of the crossroads, because she mentions that in the part where you're walking around to the lighthouses. Houses. And I was like, do I want to go straight or do I want to go right? And Elizabeth just goes, no matter which choice you make,
it's the
path
the
is like where you end up.
I did the same thing.
So I was like, oh,
amazing.
It doesn't matter.
Which is fantastic. What do you guys think of? So I guess it's about time that we start going backwards in time. So let's hit the story backwards.
We pretty much hit a lot of the earlier parts.
Cover a lot of it.
Well, what do you guys think of future Elizabeth?
You can go ahead.
Future Elizabeth?
Yeah.
Was she Lady Comstock?
No, she was Elizabeth in like the 80s. because she shows you like the future where Comstock basically takes over America.
Yeah, but like she looked a hell of a lot like Lady Comstock, especially in that dress.
Yeah, yes, that's true.
I think the whole point was that that was Elizabeth, like as she grew up in the like up to the 80s, she would have been an old lady by then.
Yeah,
she
yeah, because like I mean, is it? Do you think it's just coincidence that she, for I guess the second half of the game, wears the dress that Lady Comstock is always pictured in? Do you think that's just coincidence?
Man, now you're saying.
I think I thought she put in like she just put on that like outfit and then
because they had there
was. When but they like, were going up to Comstock House.
But she looks nothing like the pictures of Lady Comstock. Or
whatever. It was like, oh, yeah. Hi, it's Lady Comstock, even though right. you died she 19 years
like,
ago.
Lady Comstock looks like one of the president's daughters. Someone linked it today and I saw it.
Sure.
Yeah.
Sure.
But Roosevelt? Something like that.
There's a small contingent, which I'm not necessarily a part of, but I fully support their argument, which suggests that a different version of future Elizabeth, so one that didn't regret her actions, was Archangel, yeah. Which is kind of cool if you think about it.
Do you think that's DLC?
I that's what they suspect. Oh. It's in the DLC thread on Jabo. Just to be clear, and that's what okay.
I'm pretty sure
suspect.
They said that the DLC was going to be a completely separate story, had nothing to do with the main story.
Oh, that's disappointing.
Oh, that's disappointing. But sure, the story kind of speaks for itself. I'm really intrinsically interested in who Archangel is because, and there's another character who's the little girl. Like if you pick up her voxophones.
But hold on, what do you mean by like Archangel meaning the one who revealed everything to Comstock?
Yeah.
I thought that was the Angel of Columbia.
No, wasn't that just him seeing it through the Lucette's machines?
Yeah, that's one interpretation.
That's the one that makes the most sense to me.
He could just at some point he's kind of a crazy person who lies about everything. So yeah.
now that I think about it is also then that may be true mm-hmm. in terms of telling him that Booker would head to Columbia and everything.
Yeah.
But who told him to create Columbia, I guess is what you're getting at.
Yeah, exactly. Yeah.
He also made up the thing where like he was at Wounded Knee, which technically mm-hmm. was right because Booker knew it was.
Yeah. He was. But the thing is, he knew that.
Yeah, which is kind of why it's the crazy, the Slate thing now makes so much sense in retrospect.
Yeah, it does.
Yeah.
Because that's why he never like comes out and says why he hates you or wants to kill you at all, that kind of bullshit. And now you think about it, it's like, well, yeah, and that's why he was telling you the whole time, like, Comstock fucking replaced me, and he's shouting at you, and you're like, why are you shouting at me? I'm just a dude trying to kill Comstock.
Yeah, why are you so mad at me?
Yeah, and then now in retrospect, it's like, you're fucking Comstock, and so future Elizabeth, then going back further, any other highlights? There's definitely highlights of the game.
Can I just say real quick?
Sure.
Ghost Lady Comstock, I thought that was pretty dumb.
I thought that was actually really, kind of awesome.
It was really silly.
No, because
it just rubbed me the wrong way for some reason.
Because it's like it goes back to the previous theme of when you're going through all the tears of alive and dead.
It wasn't that part that bothered me. It was just more like the design of her, just making her look like
you mean
this
Master G to figure out where the fuck to go.
Or just like she's flying around everywhere, bringing people back from the dead.
Oh,
like,
right.
I thought that was kind of awesome. I thought that was kind of awesome.
Well, I was playing the game on easy, so...
That fight on hard was among the most difficult experiences I've had in a video game.
I've heard the graveyard on hard is a son of a bitch.
It is. I was playing a medium, and it was pretty hard.
Easy was hilarious. I threw a couple of grenades, and it was over.
that part of the game, though, has maybe my favorite line of dialogue in the whole game, where Book is just like, Elizabeth, why is your mother a ghost?
Oh, yeah, that was great.
Like just the delivery, like kudos to you, Troy Baker.
And then he says something, and then Elizabeth something later says like, "There's something off about my mother." And Booker's like, "Oh, really? I hadn't noticed."
No, but it's like the freaking deadpan delivery of Elizabeth. Why is your mother a ghost? Like so totally Scooby-Doo up in her.
That's another interesting part of the plot because the element of Elizabeth being Elizabeth opening tears to things she wants or things that are affected by her own wants is a question left by the game, but it's kind of explained by the end of the game because if there's an infinite amount of universes, it is conceivable that
if
there's one close
what
to
you can tear.
Yeah, there's one close to what
control
you
what
want.
You tear, you can open one that you want,
yeah,
I guess.
Yeah, that's semi-conceivable, so that's kind of explained. But yeah, you're right. The ghost, I did not expect that at all.
I actually thought the visually the design of that was really neat, especially the one in the bank. Like when you fight her there.
Was she? Did she look different between each? She looked the same.
No, it's just the way the lighting played with the indoor environment.
Yeah.
Was really neat. Let's see. Actually, if we're going to skip ahead, well,
finding out the backstory at the bank for, it wasn't the bank, it was the house. Well, it was all of them, where you find out the backstory to the twins and how, because they couldn't keep quiet, like both her, them and Comstock, Lady Comstock, couldn't keep quiet about Elizabeth. And so Comstock got them, like, ordered their deaths. But the way he ordered the deaths of the twins was to sabotage that machine. And instead of actually killing them, it kind of just spread them throughout fucking probability space, which is
Yeah. But growing, I guess, back into cool design and scaring the living shit out of me. The boys of silence, the ones
fuck
with the
you,
horns
the,
on their head.
Turning around. Fuck
Turn
you.
Turn around and there's the one there. I had,
oh, yeah, that guy.
I had a carbine, right? I dumped the full 12 rounds into him.
I had a shotgun and I just blasted like twice.
But like, it doesn't do any damage.
I was like, because there's a reason I didn't play Bioshock 1, because it's semi-horror and I can't take horror games, so I jumped out of my fucking seat when he was there.
That's scary.
Wait, what? Oh, Bioshock 1?
Yeah, I was not
Bioshock
scared
1
it.
Has some seriously scary moments.
Like, there's a couple jump scares, but...
No.
You also can't handle Dead Space, so...
I can't handle Dead Space. I cannot handle Dead Space.
No, there's one part in Bioshock where you're walking through the... I don't know what the word for it is. The, where is escaping me? Place where you keep dead people?
Mortuary?
Mortuary, thank you. Or morgue, either of those works. Mm-hmm. And you're walking through water and there's the light on the back wall and you see a shadow. And then the lights go out temporarily, come back on, and the shadow's gone. And you go back there and it's a dead end.
Is this Bioshock 1? Because that didn't happen.
Yeah, Bioshock 1. And that like freaked me out.
That stuff doesn't bother me. The one thing that did scare me though was the end of the first Dead Space. That freaked me out.
I don't know. No,
I'm not going to say that.
Some scares don't bother me because they happen and they're over.
Yeah.
Yeah.
But like, it's the anticipation of waiting for something scary to happen that kills me.
And the beauty of this is scary. It did no jump scares for the whole of the game and then did one at near the end. And I was like, fuck you.
Yeah, it was a really good one too.
Yeah, fuck you.
The things that scare me in games is more when like you don't have like the sufficient weapons or ammo to like defeat a horde of enemies, so like you're freaking out as a player.
That's not really it's not horror. That's just more I don't want to fail.
Resident Evil 4 did that really well, where you just have like waves of enemies and you can't really take them out quickly, so you're like freaking out the whole time.
Because I just finished Dark Souls, so I kind of know what you're talking about. Because it's like the sense of oh fuck, I'm being overwhelmed.
Also, just the ambience of Resident Evil 4 helped that too.
Yeah, there you go.
The thing is with that Boy of Silence jump scare is like he yells, right? So he summons all the little dudes. Mm-hmm. So I had both of those. I had the jump scare, and then I had dumped a full clip into this guy. So now I was almost low on ammo while trying to kill these other dudes.
Oh, man. Again, on easy. Just a couple grenades. It's over. I actually really liked playing it through on easy, but we'll talk about that on the actual League cast. There's a story cast.
Should we just talk real quick, what we thought of as a game? Just, really briefly.
I mean, it's probably going to be my game of the year.
It's the game to beat right now.
I think only one game in the foreseeable future can come close or top it, and that's The Last of Us. It's not because it's not because I think that this game's unbeatable, but it's a story about I actually cared about the characters. Like, there's few games out there that made me actually give a shit, and there's no game out there ever or maybe ever again that will make me give away a child for money. and just little things like that just haven't been done and just took so much balls and just were so amazing and things I wouldn't have experienced in my own life, obviously, and just crazy new experiences. The reason we play video games, new experiences, this gave us. So that's what makes it like so.
Yeah, because because The Last of Us, the way I see it, the highest for me anyway, The Last of Us can go. Is like a great game because like Uncharted 2, similarly,
I think Uncharted
2
rivals this because I cared about Nathan Lane.
See, like for me, Uncharted 2 is a great game. This is a game that reminds me why I play games, which is on a whole other level.
It's pretty spectacular. I would want to say though, like just an inference to story because we've hit most of the major story beats. Oh yeah, What's your guys' favorite parts of the game?
Like favorite like whole levels or just favorite moments?
Just favorite moments.
My favorite moment is when you find the guitar sitting on the ground and you pick it up and start playing. That's and Elizabeth sings
so many people's
favorite
moment. So many people love that moment, just picking up that guitar.
Because it's the best moment in the game.
So, well,
I might have skipped that part. I don't remember that.
Well, yeah, yeah.
It's in a one-off room.
Yeah, it's hard to find. Room, so. It's like fucking a room.
Which is, but, it's just another reason why I like it, because it is in a one-off room.
Yeah, it's like a one-off room. You have to go down some stairs and like a pub or something to find it. And the guitar isn't necessarily like some of the items, like ammo is like not. Yeah, some items are really shiny.
See it across the room.
Yes, they're really shiny, and other things they highlight less. Like lockpicks, they barely shine. This was like somewhere between lockpicks and like a gun, so it wasn't really that shiny. Didn't do that reflection thing as much, so you could miss the guitar was interactable. And like the only hint you got was when you walked into the room, Elizabeth Lex was walking around. She's like, "Oh man, this place is so dreary. Like, I wish there was something to liven it up." And then that's when
sure
I saw
she
the
says
guitar.
Like, "Hey, look at guitar." I'm pretty sure she actually said that to me at least.
I think she did as well. So I picked up the guitar, and when she said, when I saw the guitar there, I instantly realized that I could play it. Like I guessed it right then and there. Which is kind of detracted from that sequence for me. But the main thing, the one thing that seriously detracted from that sequence was, so you're sitting there playing guitar. That's awesome. The guitar sounds great. Elizabeth starts singing. She has a fantastic singing voice. Whoever they got to sing for her was
Courtney Draper. Courtney Draper actually does. The regular VO actress does the singing.
That's crazy. And so she's singing. That's amazing. The character model is dancing around. That's cute and adorable. And then she picks up the orange off the shelf and starts offering it to the little kid. And in my mind, I was like, that's that kid's orange. Like, this is his this is where he lives. You're taking his own orange and giving it to him. What are you doing, you bitch? That was literally what ruined that moment.
The kid was upstairs and he runs downstairs to hide, doesn't he?
No, I think he was already there, wasn't he?
I'm pretty sure he runs downstairs.
He might be scripted. He might be literally have been different for both of us. But at the end, he hides under the stairs.
The thing was different.
Yeah, because in the end, he hides under the stairs, and I was like, he's hiding from us. Like how my pathing worked out was he was there. He sees us. He hides under the stairs. I start playing the guitar. Then she takes his own fucking orange and gives it to him. And that was, yeah.
Yeah, but I mean, like, it's kind of like, hey, I'm not going to take this thing from you.
Yeah.
It's okay to like not hide.
Yeah. It was a wonderful moment. It was definitely memorable. But for me, it'll always be like fucking the baptism scenes and the baby stuff. Like, yeah, those, they're the most horrible scenes in that game, and also like easily the most memorable for me scenes in that game. Tyler, did he already say his favorite? What's your favorite?
I think probably have to be the part where you see the baby and the finger gets cut off, because that was just the part where like everything came together for me.
Everything clicks.
You just had
this
I now understand.
Game, like,
yeah,
that
man.
What it's doing.
Anna DeWitt on his hand.
Yeah, that when I noticed that when it was AD, I was like, oh man, that explains what that means, and also how Comstock knew that that DeWitt would have that on his hand.
So crazy. Oh.
Also, the fact that your hand gets stabbed and it's wrapped in like a cloth, you don't even see that. I thought that was really well done.
Mm-hmm. So to round out the show,
I just want to say, like, besides all the story stuff, I think Bioshock Infinite is just a fun game in general.
Yeah.
Like, the shooting is way better than the first game. The city is, like, fully realized. It runs great in the PC, besides the stuttering issue and
that's mostly
worst V-Sync. But, like, that's something...
It's the V-Sync, and then it's also, like, the dynamic shadows are super, super intensive.
Yeah, I turned that shit down, and my frame rate skyrocketed. Specifically shadows, and I told Durin to do this as well. Shadows
because they're like, it's like hardware based shadows is really weird.
It's really weird.
That's not really the game's fault. That's Iron Galaxy's fault for porting it. Thanks, Dave Lang.
I noticed they were in the credits. Did they actually do the PC?
The PC version, apparently.
Pretty sure they did.
But it's really like
I went to Dave Lang's giant mom page, and he's credited in Bioshock Infinite.
Yeah, I'm pretty sure.
I noticed
sure
Iron
he did
Galaxy
the PC
Studios part. In the credits. So wait, are you saying that Columbia was secretly floating inside the Lang zone?
Yes.
All of the lighthouses are encompassed by the Lang Zone.
They're portals to the Lang Zone. Okay, this whole game makes sense.
Dave Lang is Comstock.
Dave Lang, the Firefall booth of Bioshock Infinite. to compound as many memes as possible. No, because to round out the show, I want to talk about the world. Because we talked a lot about the core plot, but how? So you guys are American. I'm not. What did you guys think of that iteration of the American dream?
It's sort of extremely relevant because, I don't know, I feel like the state in America currently is like, I don't know, a lot of people are still coming here for the quote unquote American dream, but it has changed significantly. At least in, I don't know, the way I see it, but it's sort of like done as a caricature of America.
Definitely. Definitely.
And I think in that aspect, sort of nailed it because there is a lot of still, maybe not so much in the mainstream media like it was in, say, like the civil rights movement in like the 60s, but there's still a lot of newer immigrants are still sort of looked down upon.
Right.
There's still a lot of like just oppression in general. I wouldn't
call it oppression. I would just call it general dislike.
This is like a word exactly. Prejudice. That's
yeah.
The
word. There you go.
Because like right now, like the Supreme Court. Let's get super political here.
Sure.
Supreme Court. Ahead. They're looking over the equal marriage bill.
Oh yeah, absolutely.
Equal rights, which probably my media law professor is saying it's probably going to get thrown out just because of like standing issues and procedure.
Right.
But like that's super big in the media, and when we think about how far America has come as a nation in terms of like equal rights and like the past slavery and all like that, the
world in general,
like the world's still pretty messed up in some spots. Like as much as things have changed, things also haven't changed.
Yeah,
the more things change, the more they stay the same.
Yes.
Like,
there you go. I just summed up Bioshock Infinite. There you go. You have a phone call.
So how'd you guys think of the throwing the ball scene at the start?
What do you mean?
Because that was, like, to me, as a person, like, I live in Australia. We do have racism here, but it is, like, way tamer than anything that I've heard of from elsewhere, aside from, like, obvious countries like fucking most of the Eastern Europe, who apparently just are secular about everything.
Like Asia.
Yeah. So, sense. Like, to me, stuff like the black and white couple being put on stage and the raffle literally you throwing a ball at them and the better you get, the better your
them.
Prize.
I don't know about you guys.
I threw it at them because I didn't want to make a scene.
You seriously threw it at them?
My logic was don't make a scene.
You were in character?
Yeah, I was actually. I'm like not even joking. That was my logic. Like
getting way too into the game.
I was. I couldn't understand. I ignored the world while playing this game.
Really? That's crazy. Oh, no, you mean like the real life world. Right. That makes very much far more sense.
Yeah.
So, yeah, like stuff like that for me, it didn't resonate. So my version, my outlook of the world was, so the game opens, there's the lighthouse scene and all that stuff, and the lights from the sky, the lighthouse scene, that was incredible. Because I didn't play the first Bioshock, I didn't know much about how these things tend to open, and that was kind of cool. So we open, we get to freaking Colombia, you're traveling down an elevator in the pod that you just arrived in, and there's like the text along the walls, and so that and the essentially the text on the walls as you go down the elevator and the pre-release coverage had already told me pretty much everything I need to know about the religious fervor and the world of Bioshock Infinite. So by then, when I was then forced to go through a baptism and then walk through a garden full of people praying to the founding fathers, and then from there walking outside with every person talking about Comstock and Lady Comstock and how they wanted to be like Lady Comstock, and then throwing, like, eventually getting to the raffle and the black and white couple on stage, I was just like, I'm done. I literally put down the game for a full day because I was just overpowered. It was no subtlety whatsoever.
You'd be surprised how prevalent some of that is,
man.
Because like I know a few, like, I don't know them like well, but you know, like someone that my parents work with or something like that, who have married interracially, and like one side of the family just didn't go to the wedding.
Man.
Messed up.
It is messed up. I agree.
I haven't heard of anything like that. Like, it probably happens over here, but I just haven't heard of it ever. So this whole stuff, like, I know that it's supposed to be obvious, but the fact that perhaps I haven't been exposed to as much of it as maybe some people in the audience and you have, Shinboy, mm-hmm. just like totally just put it over the top. Like, I found the world pretty much, aside from the visuals, which I have grown to like, even though I don't particularly like the art style. I just found
more realistic than the original Bioshock, I think. Yeah. Like, it strives a little more for realism.
I think it's also limited by the engine a bit.
Yeah.
Well, just that aside, like, just the world itself, I just found grotesque and just too far forward. Like, there were some people on the forums, like, saying, like, they were disappointed by the story because they didn't want it to be a personal tale between these two people. And they wanted to find out, like, the conflict between Colombia and America. And I was like, that is because, the opposite of what I want from this game.
Because the thing is with that, a lot of people, I can see people expecting that because the best character in the first Bioshock was Rapture.
Right, yeah. Right.
So
there weren't that many characters anyway. So,
no, but I mean, like, you know, you get my point.
Yeah, the world was like the character of that game, and here is more of the backdrop. It's definitely the backdrop for this game.
It's the backdrop that sets up the characters that you actually care about.
Yeah, yeah.
See, I was a little more interested in learning like why all these racial tensions exist in there, because I actually tried to avoid as much of the marketing as I could.
Mm-hmm. Yeah,
but like I still heard all the people complaining about like all the religious and racial overtones. Mm-hmm. So as I'm playing the game, I'm listening to like people talking about how they worship the founding fathers. And then there's one point I just walk through a door and it's a giant statue of John Wilkes Booth standing there. I was like, okay, I know why people might have a problem with this.
Well, just I mean, they hate Abraham Lincoln because he liberated the Negroes.
Yeah, one of the loading screens is just a picture of Abraham Lincoln, like with devil horns.
Yeah, exactly.
John Wilkes Booth has like a halo on him.
That's a piece of art in the game.
You can see that in the game. In that same building, I think, on the wall.
Yeah, it's in there, like the Hall of Fathers or whatever.
Totally,
Hall
of Heroes. Totally amazing. It's cohesive and it's fully put together and it's consistent throughout the entire game. I was just hoping for a little bit more subtlety.
Because it's not subtle because it's there to drive the point home.
Yeah. And thankfully it kind of fades out. Part, like, first 2 hours is the bad part. And then you kind of like,
yeah, because like the thing is, because I guess they knew that it was only going to be the first section of the game. They had to cram as much of it in there to get it in your mind that this is what the city's about.
Yeah.
See, I actually kind of appreciated that though, because like as you walk in the city, you know like everything that's going on. So it's not like as you progress, you have to learn about it. Like, you know.
Yeah, it's there for the people who aren't going to go around collecting the audio logs and everything. Right. That they know what's going on without doing that extra searching.
Right, right. And that was by aside from the saving issue.
Oh yeah, that's weird.
That was my main gripe with the game. Oh, and the clones issue. Like, again, at the start of the game, you're forced to do a baptism. I was standing there trying to figure out a way to not do it. I looked around the crowd surrounding me. It's just like two character models repeated over and over again. I was just
but that's,
they're also wearing robes. Oh, man. So
yeah, well, they
wasn't that.
They but I mean, the thing is, when it gets to stuff like that, like, that's a lot of modeling you have to do.
Yeah, yeah. And not
so
being interrupted NPCs.
How good this game looked.
Oh, yeah.
You're welcome to PC gaming.
Like, all the footage they've shown was just the, like, Xbox and PS3 or whatever. Mm-hmm. And then it's like day and night for the PC, because I've looked at comparison videos.
I dropped the coin.
Well done.
Was it heads or tails?
Actually, it was heads. God
nice.
Damn it.
Nice.
Different loop. We've done this podcast 121 times.
And with that... anything else we need to say? The game was awesome. I loved it.
Yeah, I can do
a podcast about it.
I'm trying to think if there's any major moments that I really enjoyed.
Do you want to talk about?
Oh, there was one. When you need the code for the elevator, I saw it and I was like, "No, you didn't, Ken Levine. The code is 0451."
Which
if you go back, is the code that unlocks the first door in the first Bioshock. And if you go further back,
cute,
it unlocks like some I think it might be like 000451 or something like something similar to that. Unlocks the first unlockable thing in System Shock 2. And if you go even further back, I believe to the first System Shock, there's a code that involves a 0451 that unlocks something there.
That's kind of cool.
Going further back, it's Ken Levine's address from when he was a kid.
Is it?
No.
It's probably something significant to him, though. It probably is, something like that.
Yeah, so I saw that and I was like, God damn it, of course.
Yeah. There's something that fucking came to me and I completely fucking blanked on.
Yeah, but that whole scene is cool because that's the same scene where... Oh, continue.
So... because we need to round this out, but what do you guys think of going through that first tear into the gunsmith's world?
What do you mean?
So they stood there and the gunsmith was dead and the terror shows up and the twins explain it. And when Elizabeth says, I'm not sure if we can get back if we go through this tear, I was like, then just don't go through it. Just don't. What are you doing? Stop. What is this madness? What? You don't even know what's over there. It's another world. What's wrong with you?
See, the game player in me was like, she told me we can't go through this. Oh, once you go through, we can't go back. Is this the end of this game already? Because that's like something you hear, like the point of no return.
Well, they
like,
did that like, with the turnstiles at the end.
You better do it now.
Yeah, like the turnstiles at the end, they totally did that. It's like Elizabeth standing next to the turnstiles. Yeah, hey, these turnstiles only turn one way. We can't come. What are you talking about? The turnstile.
That first tear, I had like a cipher nearby that I could have done, but I just didn't feel like doing.
Right.
So I just went through it.
But the cool thing is you can still do it on the other side. Like it's a bunch of stuff, like things you searched are still there, having been searched.
Because I think most of the tears, you don't jump in time that much.
Yeah, yeah.
Most of them are just like...
Except for at some point you jump like 80 years randomly.
And there's the 6 months after you come back from future Elizabeth, which is kind of freaky.
Yeah, because like she gets all sad and it's I'll wait for you, but you never can.
Terrible. Oh my God.
No, me too.
Oh, being tortured for 6 months.
It's like, no, it's only been a few minutes.
It's literally only been a few goddamn minutes. So like just going through that tear just pissed me off. And that's kind of when, that's like kind of the big moment where it's like, oh shit, this game's going to go sideways real quick. Because once you start fucking hopping into alternate dimensions where you're like a martyr and everyone's like, there's like huge posters of you on the wall, which is kind of crazy.
And the Vox Populi, I think you're an imposter.
They're
shooting you.
Point where Elizabeth kills Fitzroy is so fucked up.
It is. And then she cuts her hair and she becomes Elizabeth.
I thought it was really well done. I thought it was really
well done. I mean, it is, but like, she stabs her and she's like, oh shit. Like, standing there just covered in blood. Like, the fuck did I do?
Yeah, because there's blood, like, all over her after she does that. It's kind of totally crazy.
And then I like when she comes back later with her hair cut. It's like, oh wait, it's Elizabeth. Hey, like they've shown in every trailer.
I'd literally forgotten that is what like the ads have been showing me as Elizabeth, because
everyone was complaining that like they changed her model, but even that she has like different costume changes basically.
Right.
Yeah, Ken Levine was just like, no, we didn't change it, it's just a different costume, get over it. I mean, pretty much what I'm saying is Ken Levine.
Yeah, because there you go. Like, because this one, like her original suit wasn't as busty, and in the new one you can see huge amounts of cleavage. Like he's literally like, these are...
I think originally she's also supposed to be younger. He might have made her a little older.
Right. Well, she kind of looks like a 20-year-old. She doesn't look...
Yeah, I mean, a cartoon.
She sounds like one.
But it kind of totally makes sense, because if you look at pictures of Lady Comstock, she's wearing that busty dress, and then Elizabeth puts it on at the end. So it's like... So yeah, again, like cynicism can kill this industry. I totally feel for Ken Levine, because he had to leave.
This is coming from a person whose username is self-confessed cynic.
Exactly. It's like, well, I actually... came up with that username before I had truly met the internet. So apparently
I called you. I mean, you were like, you've been drumming up this ending so much. Now I feel like I can't help but be disappointed by it. Mm-hmm. And I'm just like, that's because you're a cynical asshole. And you just go, I do not deny this.
Yep.
I was kind of half joking there, but I do agree that I can be very cynical at times.
See, I'm the person that gets way too excited over things that I probably shouldn't.
Mm.
Yeah, that's why I say I'm cautiously optimistic about a lot of things. Like, no,
I want to be optimistic,
but I don't want to be too optimistic and then be disappointed.
Like, I am all in. Like, I am all in on Transistor, and I am all in on Cyberpunk 2077.
Damn straight.
Like, I don't care. So far, we have nothing negative really to go on.
That's true.
And with that, I'm sad we couldn't end it on a terrible joke.
Even if you didn't.
We just spent over an hour and a half talking about just the ending of this game. Basically, that tells you all you should need to know. I mean, if you're listening this far, you've probably played the game.
Yeah, well, you should. I hope.
Yeah, I don't know why I'm telling people they should play the game.
You should.
They probably played it, but they're listening to this.
Yeah, like we kind of spoiled.
If you play Bioshock Infinite, you should play the game.
Like every major plot point in the game.
Pretty much.
But hey.
I mean, except for the part where Elizabeth pretty much tells you that she recognizes the twins and tells you who they are. I mean, we didn't mention that, but that's implied from what we all talked about. When you're riding up the gondola. And Elizabeth's just like, oh, I recognize her. She's the one who figured out how to make the city float.
Yeah. That makes sense because, like, at the start of the game, after you'd met her once, there's like the video thing, and you look in, and it's like the tears throughout the world, like just before you meet Elizabeth. And it's like, our smartest lady won't say a word, and it's her. I'm like, hey, that's the chick who's been visiting me this whole time.
Who are also the two people on the boat at the very beginning. God, this game is so good.
Probably stop here before we go on for another hour and a half.
I just recount elements of the game and go, God, this game is so good. So thank you for listening to this very special episode of
the Lincoln/
Scotchcast. I don't know what I'm going to name this, so don't be surprised either way. But I hope you liked the game. I liked it. Shinboy liked it. Tyler liked it. So there you go. Cheers.
It's a video game.
Do we have any bad jokes? We have to finish this on a bad joke. Simboy, you're the bad joke guy.
Oh, hang on. I have one courtesy of Tyler at the end of PAX.
Mm-hmm. We were leaving
from PAX. We were all just beat after the weekend. And as we were driving away in like the bus going back to like the parking lot, Tyler just goes, I have reached maximum capacity.